You would bear my cross. This morning, that's right. Who are you?
Child of God.
Oh, all right, good answer. Who are you?
Child of God.
I am who you say I am. Everybody say, God.
God.
I am.
I am.
Who you say I am.
Who you say I am.
Yeah, there you go. Now you know the words of the song. You glad for that?
Amen.
You're not who the devil says you are, not who the neighbor says you are.
That's right.
It's who God says you are.
That's right.
I am who you say I am.
That's right.
Amen. Holy Spirit. You are welcome.
Yes.
Come in this place.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes.
Holy
in this place.
we just love you this morning. We give you praise. We give you glory. We thank you for being so kind, so good, so faithful, so loving. Lord, just bless your people this morning. Minister to each and every one. And we just give you all the praise in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. And God bless each and every one of you. Great to have you all here this morning. There's still room up here on the front pews. For those of you that are just getting here, that's what you get for being late. You got to sit up front. All right. Well, welcome everybody. We're welcome to Good Lucerne Valley Community Church. Glad to have you all with us there.
Amen.
Okay, and we're just going to have a good time with the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And you'd like to keep supporting us out there. We're P.O. Box 788, Lucerne Valley, California, 92356. And so we just welcome that. Of course, everybody's gas bill's gone up, right?
Yeah.
Well, so is ours. So send money. That's good. We'd like to also announce that Wednesday night, we're just so proud that a lot of activity last week. We had a great crowd here last Wednesday night, probably 40, 50 people. And the last couple of weeks, and we just welcome you to come. We're just having a great time of the Lord on Wednesday night. And just have a good time with us. Charlene,
yes.
Are you out there?
Uh-huh.
You had something to say this morning. Will you speak good and loud for us, please?
Community here at the USDA, we gave away 3,080 pounds of food there, and then at our church Friday, we did 500 pounds.
Good.
Yeah. Beautiful ladies right here, Pastor Gloria, everybody that helps the food ministry. What a blessing you guys are. Thank you.
All right, just a lot of things going on, so we invite you to get involved. Some people say, well, I want to get involved. We'll show up.
There you go.
Show up, we'll put you to work, no problem. Okay, lots of things taking place. So Ralph has some words of wisdom for us this morning. Okay. All right, here we go. Who are the children of the devil? Whoever does not pursue righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not love his brother. God wants us to love each other.
That's right.
Not hate each other, or not judge each other. For this is the master that you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. That's what God keeps telling us, to love one another.
Amen.
A lot of times we sit there and we judge people. We're ready to jump on people instead of saying, I love you.
Yes.
We're ready to jump on them for anything they say. Do not be surprised, brothers, that the world hates you. We know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brothers. Love, love. That's what God is about, love. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer. That's how much God thinks about that. If you hate your brother, is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. So God's telling us to love one another.
That's right.
Amen.
You know, a lot of times, ever since I've been talking up here, I notice a lot of people, they're not listening to the message. They listen to what I'm saying, but they say, oh, I got him this time. He said something wrong. instead of loving his brother, he's ready to judge him right away. Oh, I got something on him. Because I know, because when I first became a Christian, I used to hear the pastors talking, and I said, I'm going to catch him in something. And I'm really going to give it to him, because he's going to be wrong. But that's the way I thought. And I know I'm not the only one that thinks like that. There's so many people are ready to judge people. Why do you wear these clothes? Why do you comb your hair that way? Because that's me.
Amen.
And I love the Lord.
Amen.
And I love all you guys, really. And if you hate me, that's on you, not on me. Okay? So let's say a prayer. Lord, I just thank you for another day, Lord. And I thank you for our pastor, my God. And I thank you for all the people that are in here, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Oh, yeah.
And now, Rob, protect the altar. Stand with me as we go to the Lord in prayer. We have a host of requests this morning. Edna's daughter-in-law suddenly had a cardiac situation and passed away yesterday, and she's on her way to Hawaii to be with them early this morning.
Minnesota.
That was Minnesota. Okay. I got to think of the boy over there. Okay. Very good. So she's on her way back there with them. We have Wade up here also. And we have Denise's daughter, Crystal, that we want to remember her in prayer also. And Tyson, Edna's son, of course. And Lorraine is doing better, by the way.
Amen.
Yeah, give God a hand. So we just got a lot going on, all right? And Noretta's grandchildren also, we want to pray for them also. They're going through some situations, and you'll hear a little bit more about that as she sings this morning. But let's just go to the Lord in prayer now.
Yeah.
Father, we just have so much on our plate, Lord, and you've blessed us so much. And we just ask you to keep ministering to each and every one of all these needs. Be with Edna's family back there. Be with Denise and her family here, and Noretta and her family. Don Jeffries and his situation, Lord, minister to them. Just each and every one, Lord, almost too many for us even to remember, but you know each and every one. We just ask that you touch them, minister to them through the power of your Holy Spirit, and we thank you for the work that you're doing in Lorraine, and we just ask you to continue on and minister to her and her whole family and Bruce. And we're just going to give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Amen. You may be seated. Now Doretta is going to sing us a song.
I don't normally sing with the canned music, but I need you to pray for me. I lost a box full of accompaniment tapes, probably thousands of dollars worth. Then I'll find it in Jesus' name. Today is a hard day for me and Margaret and Tina. And
we can't hear you.
You can't hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Well, today is a hard day, but I know that I have victory in Christ Jesus. I know we do. We do, huh, babe? Today's my son Christopher's birthday. It's been 2 years since he went home. I pray that this song will encourage those who have lost a child or a loved one. We know, without a shadow of a doubt, where we're going. I know, without a shadow of doubt, where my son went. And he's in glory.
Amen.
And that's what makes it easier for me to handle today. Because he made it, he finally made it home. The hard part is us who's still here. I know God has a plan and a purpose. We are his children. And we are ambassadors for his kingdom. An ambassador is an accredited diplomat sent by his country as an official representative to a foreign country. We don't belong to this world.
That's right.
We're just here. We are representatives with a job to do, to tell others about Christ, to pray for those loved ones who are lost and need direction. Our job is to be a prayer warrior, as well as going out and sharing the gospel and the good news to others. And when our job is done, we can finally make it home.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
The words are up there. You can sing with me.
Tell him all about the man that I became, and hope that it pleased him. There's so much I want to say, so much I want you to know. When you're yeah.
Lots of people that we need to pray for. This weekend, we have one of our old members from okay. Another prayer request for Johnny Adonis.
Teresa's husband.
Oh, yeah. We did. Teresa has Wade. Oh, Johnny. Okay, the other, Teresa, not Denise. Teresa. Okay, yeah, okay. And we also have rural parade services are going to be this weekend at 12 o'clock here at the church. Some of you might remember him. He used to attend the church years ago, and he and Elsie. And so we invite you. I'm sure the family would be glad to invite you all here at 12 o'clock on Saturday this coming week. We remember their prayer also. So let's remember Johnny. Teresa's husband, he's lost a lot of weight, and so he needs God's help. Father, we just love you so much. We just give you, again, another request that we're sure that you're aware of. We ask for Earl Perrett's whole family, and now Teresa, her husband, Johnny, we just ask for you to minister to him and that family also. And we just give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, the Lord's good. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, find a Bible and open it up. We'll be all over the place. All right. How many of you know you're loved of God?
Amen.
I don't care what you've done, where you're at, what you've been doing, or if you're watching online or out there in person. Or no matter what you think your status is, I want you to know that God loves you.
That's right.
While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Yep.
We were in the midst of our rebellion, whatever, God loves you.
Amen.
And for you saints, for those of you who've accepted Christ, of course you already know that, right? That Jesus loves you. Yep. And when I want to talk to you about something else, there's no doubt about God's love. He loves us and he's demonstrated that love towards us. But I want to talk to you about your love towards God. God proved his love towards us. And then while we were yet sinners, he loved us. Sent his son to die for us, John 3:16. We all know it by heart. The manifestation of his love, sacrificing his son to pay for our redemption, our salvation, our justification, to give us new life. God proved his love for us, but what do we do? How do we manifest, or how are we manifesting our love towards God? How is that manifested? Loving God includes obeying his commandments. Whoa. Well, that's a stopper right there for most of us, right? Believing in his word, thanking him for all that he has done and is doing. A deep desire to know him better. A desire to be with him and love God and adoring and just rejoicing in who he is.
Yes.
How do you manifest your love towards God? Wow. Well, what's God's love look like? It's unchangeable. It's divine. It's self-sacrificing, it's inseparable, it's constraining, it's everlasting, it's manifested by his death. We preach a lot about his love towards us. We sing a lot of songs, such love, abiding love, what manner of, what wondrous love is this, what manner of love is this. the love of God, how rich and pure, how marvelous and strong. We sing all these things about him, but what does your love look like? Is it faithful? Is it dependable? Is it constant? Is it pure? Is it 100%? Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with what? When it's convenient. When I don't have anything else to do. How does your love look to the world? What are you telling the world about the way you love God? Or what are you showing the world about the way you love God? It's a different story, isn't it, when we look at it? Some interesting stories in the Bible that tells us about the love of God. Interesting precepts. You know, we get caught up in obedience, and obedience is a big part of loving God. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll what? Obey. Keep my commandments. But sometimes we get stuck there, but real love goes beyond commandment. It's just not legislative. Does God want to legislate his love towards us? Do you want to put us in a hammerlock and force us to love us? Is that the kind of love he wants?
No.
Which kind of love does he want?
Unconditional.
Agape love.
Agape love. But how does he want that demonstrated? How is that shown? How is that proven? Wow. Jesus has an interesting story, a story I love, because it talks about fishing. And you're all familiar with it. But in this story, he invites the disciples to come to breakfast. It's an interesting concept. Jesus has been crucified. He's resurrected. He's already seen the disciples a couple of times. This is the third time now. Peter's been hiding out with the rest of the disciples in the upper room. And finally, he decides, he says, I'm going fishing. Man after my own heart. And all the other disciples said, we're going too. Well, you have to understand that they were professional fishermen. This is what they did before Christ. So they were going back now to what they were comfortable in doing. What did Christ call them from? Fishing. And he told them what? Follow me and I will make you what?
Fishers
of men. But now Jesus is gone, things have changed. And they're going back to where they were, what they were comfortable with, what they knew, or they thought they knew anyway. Yeah. And Peter said, I'm going fishing. You have to understand, he was the oldest of the disciples. It is thought by most theologians that he actually had a fleet of fishing boats. He was quite well versed in fishing, how to catch fish. That's how they made their livelihood. They fished. Or so they go fishing. And then the rest of the disciples says, we're going too, in John 21:3. And they went out immediately and got into the boat. And that night they caught nothing. Ooh, that's hard for a fisherman to admit. They caught nothing. But when the morning came, everybody's, when the morning comes.
When the morning comes.
Who is standing on the shore?
Jesus.
They had caught nothing. But Jesus stood on the shore, and yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Then Jesus says to them, children, have you any food? Have you caught anything? Hey guys, have you got any fish on your stringer? Now they're like me, and if another fisherman asked me, and if I'd had him on a stringer, I wouldn't tell him. Because I don't want him fishing next to me. But Jesus is a long ways off, about 200 meters or so, and he's standing on the shore, and he's hollering at him, do you have anything? Have you caught anything? And Peter's honest. He says, no, we haven't caught a thing. Now, this is kind of a crazy sight, because they have fished how long?
All night.
And yet this stranger, who they don't even recognize yet, gives them instructions. They say, cast your nets on the other side and you'll catch some. Now that's crazy. Cast the net on the right side of the boat. Maybe that's significant, the right side. of the boat, and you will find some. Now, most of us fishermen are pretty bullheaded. We want to do it our way. I'll bait the hook the way I want to bait my hook. Right, Mike? You're going to do things your way. You got your own magic sauce for those catfish, right? Yeah, your own technique. Yeah, and they don't share it with just everybody. Maybe with his daughter, but she usually beats him anyway, so it doesn't matter. But they follow the instructions of this complete stranger. How wide is a traditional fishing boat that they have?
6 to 8 feet.
Maybe 16 to 20 feet long, possibly. So it's not very big. So what difference is 6 feet going to make? 8 feet. Make it generous. Give them 8 feet. He says, cast it on the right side and you'll catch some. Now, how does he know? He's standing on the bank. He's not fishing. Or is he? But they do what he says. Fished all night. I guess maybe they have the attitude, what do we have to lose? We've been here all night. Let's do it one more time. We're tired. We're worn out. We're ready to go home. We're ready to pack it in. But one more. How many fishermen have gone? One more fishing hole. One more cast. And they throw it out. And what happens? They get so many fish that they can't even handle them. And they cast now, and they were unable to draw in it because of the multitude of fish. Therefore, the disciple whom Jesus loved, everybody say, John,
said to Peter,
the leader, it is the Lord. He recognizes Jesus how?
By his actions.
By his actions. By his commandment. By his knowledge. Wow. It is the Lord. Now, when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garments, because he had already taken them off. Why would he put on his outer garments? To honor the Lord. And what's he going to do? Now, he's taken his jacket off, which you'd think would be the thing to do if you're going to get in the water, right? Because it'd be very hard to swim with one of these things on, soaking wet. But he puts it on. And he does what? The Bible says he plunges into the water. Ba-whoosh. Why is he in such a hurry to get to the bank? What had Peter just done? Before the crucifixion, what did Peter do?
Denied him
three times. That was his suggestion. It's not said, but maybe he was in a hurry to get to Jesus before everybody else, make sure that everything was all right. Wanted to make repentance. Or maybe he just really desired to see the Lord and let him know how much he loved him.
Amen.
So he didn't wait for the boat. He didn't wait to see how deep the water was. The Bible says he plunged in and he went to shore. It's the Lord. Put on his outer garments. And he plunged into the sea. But the other disciples came in a little boat, and there was more than one boat, for they were not far from land, but about 200 cubits, dragging the nets with fish. Then as soon as they had come to land, they saw a fire and coals there, and fish laid on it. Wow. And bread. Fish and bread already on the coals. Where were the fish they caught? They were still out in the sea or in the net. How did Jesus get these fish? Amazing. He didn't need no net. He didn't need no boat. Sounds like creation, come forth.
Amen.
He's preparing what?
Dinner.
Breakfast. For who? for the sons of Zebedee, the bad-tempered, for the meek and the mild, for the denier, for those that ran away and hid. He's preparing breakfast. Wow. And he invites them. It's like the old hymn, "Come and Dine," the master calleth, "Come and Dine." Come and see the Jesus table all the time. For he who fed the multitude turned the water into wine. Calleth to the hungry, "Come and Dine." What happens when you sit down to have a meal with a friend? See, it's beyond obedience here. It is fellowship. It's sharing. It's a desire just to be with one another. Real love. What happens when you sit down at a table with Jesus? Intimacy. Friendship. You share. Now, I don't know if you've ever seen a bunch of fishermen together or not, but I have. And I've been there with some of you. And what happens when we get together? Well, usually the fish grow. But besides all that, what happens?
Fellowship.
You share. You share with one another. You share stories. You get close. You learn about one another. You get intimate. You get close. When's the last time you invited Jesus to dinner? And I'm not talking about repeating some recited prayer over dinner or at lunch. I'm talking about having a time of fellowship, where you really kneel with Jesus, you really sit with Jesus, and you share. And you allow him to share. And you tell him your stories. You desire to have that fellowship. You want to hear what's in his heart. You want to know about the last catch. And he wants to hear your heart and know what's going on. How do you manifest your love? Jesus said to them, he said, "Bring some of the fish which you have caught." Then Peter went up, and he dragged the net to the land full of large fish, 153. It's interesting because they say that represents every species that were known on the planet at that time. Wow. What is Jesus really talking about with these guys? What kind of a meeting, breakfast, was this really all about? Well, he had called them from what? He had called them from fishing to make them fishers of
men.
And now they just dragged in a net full of fish, and some of the species they probably weren't even familiar with, but they represented all of mankind. And Jesus had given them an illustrated sermon. "I have called you to be fishers of men." Wow. Bring the ones you've caught. Wow. Let's have breakfast together. How many would like to sit down at Jesus' table and have breakfast with him?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
That'd be amazing. Would you be a little nervous to begin with? Oh, you shouldn't be. But I think we would be respectively so, maybe. Maybe a little shy. Because what could you tell him? Lord, you already know everything.
Yes.
You wouldn't dare tell him a fish story. Because he really knows how big they were. He knows what they weighed. His scale may be different than your scale. He knows exactly. So they brought him. Then he said to them, "Come and eat breakfast." Come and eat breakfast. Come. I know where you've been. I know you've been hiding. I know you've been afraid. But you still got a future. And before you go out and fulfill what I've called you to do, let's have dinner. Let's talk. Let's share. Spend some time with me. Come and dine. Come and dine. Come and dine. What's that mean to you? Come and dine. When Jesus calls you to breakfast, what's he really calling you to?
Fellowship.
Fellowship? Follow him.
Understand him.
Communion. Communion. Commune. What's that mean? Sharing. Rejoicing in one another and in who you are. Can you imagine Jesus wanting to spend time with Richard? Amazing. Tommy. Jesus says, come on. Come and dine. I've already got fish on the fire, bread on the fire. Come and dine. Come and spend time with me. Let's share. Yes, you need to be obedient. Yes, 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 yes. But more importantly, beyond obedience is rejoicing in who he is. Rejoicing in who he is. Enjoying who he is. Experiencing who he is. And he goes on. And Jesus then came and took the bread, and he gave it to them, and likewise the fish. When's the last time you had dinner with Jesus? You invited Jesus to come and dine. Jesus, I'm going to go someplace. I'm going to go back here in my office. I'm going to go in my bedroom. I'm going to go in the bathroom. Wherever it is, maybe you can get alone. And he said, Lord, let's just spend some time together. Come and talk to me. I want to talk to you. Not asking necessarily for anything. Just spending time rejoicing in who he is. And what he's done. And what he's doing. And what does he have in store for you? Experiencing his love. And he experiencing your love, your adoration. Your gratitude. When's the last time you just invited him to dinner and said, Lord, I just want to let you know how thankful I am. I'd just like to spend some private time with you and just tell you how great I think you are. Thank you for everything you've done for me, Lord. Wow. Jesus, can I buy you breakfast? Can I buy you lunch? Time with the Lord, not duty. The jobs come as a product of your love and devotion, not the cause of it. Wow. What would you talk about? Wow, I bet we'd all have questions. If I asked you right now, there'd be a multitude. What would be the first thing you'd want to ask the Lord if you sat down and had breakfast with him? What would be the first thing you'd say? Good morning, Lord.
Is my name in your book?
I have a few questions here taken out of Isaiah I'd like to ask you. Yeah. What do you want me to do, Lord? How can I put a smile on your face? He'd probably say, you just did. What's your love for him look like? How is it manifested? Wow. What would you ask him? What would you share? Wouldn't you feel a little bit strange? Because you know he knows everything. So who's the sharing really for? Maybe it's just you regurgitating. Maybe you might want to ask him about forgiveness. Bitterness. Hurt. How do I heal this thing, Lord? How do I get this pure and clean like yours? How do I learn to think like you think? Lord, could I ask you for some help? I'm going to ask the Lord for help.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
With what? Everything.
Oh, my God.
Everything. Wow. What would you learn? You think you'd learn anything sitting with the Lord?
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
You think you'd learn anything sitting with the Lord, spending time, just you and Him, over lunch, over breakfast? Really sharing your heart? Wow. Maybe a great way to really manifest your love towards God is just simply inviting to breakfast or lunch. Dinner, whatever. Another way, of course, Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep me, keep my commandments. But I almost didn't want to talk about that because we get all wrapped up in the commandments part sometimes as if the love is always legislated. And real love is beyond legislation. It's beyond the rules. Real love is from the heart. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with what?
All your duty.
It's not about duty. It's about love. It's about a response to His love. Wouldn't you just spend time with your lover, the lover of your soul? Yes, keep His commandments. So that's just because you love Him. You don't do the commandments and then love Him, or that's how you gain favor with God. You do the commandments because if you love, it's all based on love. Then, 1 John 14:20 says this, and at that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. It's not easy, because we deal with our flesh. But the commandments are a result of the way we love God. They're not the cause of it. Wow. More than obedience. Rejoice in the Lord always. Matthew 11:29-30. Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and do what?
Learn
to me. Now, what he was talking about was a Jewish law, which is a heavy yoke of legislation, legalism. And he said, my yoke's a lot easier than that. My yoke is a lot lighter than all of that. Take my yoke upon you, because it's lighter, it's more comfortable. But the yoke was designed to do what? It was put on the shoulders of the oxen to do what?
To
pull, to dig, to plow, to do the job. But Jesus says, I got a new and modified. I got a better idea, better than Ford. And I've designed a yoke just for you. My yoke is easy. It's full of grace and it's full of mercy.
Amen.
It's not legislation.
Amen.
It's mercy and grace because I love you. Take my yoke upon you. Listen to what he says next up. Take my yoke upon you and do what? And learn. Of me. Learn of me. Learn of me. That's what we're doing this morning.
Amen.
That's what we'll do Wednesday night. Learn of the Lord. Manifest your love towards Him. We have a Sunday school. It ought to be full in the morning, that adult class. She does a wonderful job back there.
Yes, she does.
There's opportunity to learn of the Lord. How do you manifest your love towards God? By getting to know Him. With the old song, getting to know you, getting to know all about you. Anybody remember that?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Only about five of us. And we're all over 50. Wow. Getting to know you. My yoke is easy. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. The New Revised Standard Version says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. How many of you want rest for your souls?
Oh, yeah.
Then get to know the Lord. Get to know the Lord. How do you grow your faith? Get to know the Lord. How do you get victory? Get to know the Lord. The knowledge that passes all understanding. Get to know the Lord. To think like Jesus. Get to know the Lord. How do I deal with the world? Get to know the Lord. Learn of Him. Let your love be manifested like His love was in everything. Wow. What does your love for Jesus look like to the world? Is it selfless, everlasting, pure, faithful, loyal, dependable, sacrificial? Is He really your number one? Have you really responded to His love? Wow. That'd really be kind of tough maybe the first time we asked Him to breakfast because we had never asked Him before. How many finds it sometimes hard when you know you should have been doing something and you haven't done it for a long time and then finally you man up and you're going to do it? You kind of come in, I'm sorry I didn't do that. I'm the only one who's ever done that, right?
Oh, no.
None of you have ever done anything like that.
Every day.
And we might have a little egg on our face when we start. What did Peter do?
Wow.
What was going through his mind when John said, it's the Lord? Whew. Man. I just betrayed Him. He called me Cephas, the rock in which you build the church, and I betrayed Him. I was one of the head disciples. I betrayed Him. He told me I would be the head of the church, and I betrayed Him. I let Him down. Lord, I let You down. And He put on His coat, and He plunged into the water. I need to see Jesus. Egg on my face and all. I need to make it right. I need to start again. I need to get going. Wow. And Jesus, after breakfast, Jesus is so kind, so polite, sitting around the guys, they're all eating fish that both he had prepared. Oh, Mike, how could you sit there and eat his fish? Wouldn't you want to know where he got him, how we got him, how we caught him? All of us fishermen want to know, what kind of bait did you lose? What? How'd you get them? We'd be all caught up in that probably. But Jesus says, come and eat. Come and eat. Because Jesus really wasn't concerned about the fish or the bread. He was there to do what? He was there to fellowship with His disciples. He was there to enjoy them and instruct them and build them up. So then, when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, wow, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? I don't know if he's talking about the fish or the world's circumstances or what it was at the time, but it could very well be the fish, because that's what he did for a living before the crucifixion. Lovest thou me more than these? Do you really love me more than fishing? Do you really love me more than going to a sports game? Or watching the Boston Celtics? Or the Dodgers? Do you love me more than these? And Simon Peter said, Lord, you know I love you. Wow. Then Jesus said, feed my lambs. In other words, go to work. Do what you were called to do. But Jesus didn't let it go. And he said to him again a second time, Simon Peter, son of Jonah, do you love me? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know I love you. And he said, tend my sheep, be faithful, be dependable. Wow. Why are you just sitting here? You've been given a job to do. And then Jesus said to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? And at this time, Peter's a little upset, perhaps. It says he was grieved because he said to him three times, how many times does the Lord have to talk to you? Oh, three times? How many times has he lifted me up? How many times did he my burden share? How many times has he picked me up? How many times has he sent me on my way? How many times? And Simon Peter said, Lord, you know all things. Lord, you know, I don't have to tell you, you know all things. But Jesus is saying, yeah, but I want to hear you say it. I want you to finally get the point, Peter. I want you to understand this is beyond just words. This is a relationship you and I have. This is more than just words. Listen. Peter, son of Jonah, do you love me? Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus says, be obedient. Go to work. Do what I've called you to do. Feed my sheep. Wow. I wonder this morning, not out of duty, but out of love. Would you just stand with me this morning? I don't want you to love the Lord this morning out of obedience. I want you to love the Lord out of emotion, dedication, purity. I want you to love the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind, and all your soul, and all your strength. I want you to ask the question, when's the last time you've invited Jesus to dinner, to breakfast? Lord, I just want to get to know you better. Will you come and have breakfast with me? Let's go someplace private and let's just share. I love you. I just want to exalt you. I want to enjoy you. I want to rejoice in you. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say,
rejoice.
Wow. Father, we love you. We just ask, Lord, for a deeper relationship this morning. We've seen your love, Lord, and we just thank you for it. It overwhelms us how much you've loved us and what you've done for us. We think about all that you have done and how many times you've picked us up and how many times, Lord, you've forgiven us and you've recommissioned us and you've sent us on our way. Well, Lord, I feel this is a mighty little church that you have called out to do your work.
Amen.
In a bigger and greater way than ever before. Teach us, Lord. Teach us, Lord, to learn of you. To learn of you and grow in you. Let the world see our love towards you. Let us be a shining light to the community. To everybody about how much we love the Lord. Let our love to you be obvious. Lord, we invite you to dine. You've invited us to come and dine. Lord, we want to invite you. Come and dine. Come and dine. Lord, I want to learn of you. I want to learn more of you. And we just give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I wonder if there'd be anybody here this morning with every head bowed and every eye shut. Maybe you don't know what I was talking about. Maybe you don't have a relationship with God. And I'd like to invite you to have that relationship. If you don't know Him, if you're not sure of your relationship with God, if you're not positive that if something was to happen, you would go to heaven, you're not sure your sins are forgiven, you just raise your hand and say, Pastor, would you pray for me? I'd love to pray with you and for you. I'd like to invite you into the kingdom of God. Anybody here with a hand who want to give you the opportunity to experience God's love? Father, again, we love you. We give you praise. We give you glory. We thank you for being so good and so kind and so loving. Your love is overwhelming. Now, Lord, teach us to love you. Teach us to love you. And may our love be obvious. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. We got stuff prepared for you in the back. We'll see you back there. The Lord bless you.
Pastor, I'd like to talk to you.
Okay.
We've had a dilemma.
With that camera.
We've had a dilemma in our prayer. A woman killed her husband.